boosted up the internet here.
In the booth?
Yeah.
Wow.
With this computer.
Dude, that was great. I remember that. Stage. Mm-hmm. Remember how it worked? I only had it for a moment.
Or they actually put it in
the
yeah. Hey, can I use that chair?
No.
Yes.
Or I can't see it.
What? I have a lot of feelings about it.
Do you lock that far one for you?
No, you want to watch?
Yes.
Yeah.
Alright, I'll hang up. Yeah, take out your stage lights. And the audience is coming in, so you want like middle and rear.
Middle and rear.
And you pull the balcony on the stage. So you want the low balcony on? Hello? Why is there only one viewer? It's coming. No, we have five. When you abandon your room,
oh my God. See, I would respect these students
not
because all the students will be back. So you just kind of punch good. Me not like seeing it.
Thank you. This is your transition to the little more like side and turn the horns over to his shoot air.
Are you pressing the button? I just think it's my friend.
Thank you.
see you again. We are very excited. We have so much great music for you tonight. And I am so excited to be back here and be able to hear the musicians playing together again. But I'm not going to talk to you too much tonight. I'm just going to turn it over to Jay, and he's going to introduce our first piece. Here we are.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Spring Orchestra Fest concert at FCS. I'm Jay, a graduating senior. Before we start, I just wanted to thank Mr. Brady for everything he did to put this off. since this year we have a thing of integrity, I have something to confess right now. I am not a blue viola player. I still have the beginner marker tape on my viola. Matter of fact, I was not able to master every piece I had in the past 3 years. and I was the only viola we had, so nobody can tell me if I was wrong or right. Sad Mr. Bradley. Thank you for not, special shout out to you too, composing a beginner version of music for me in my first year here. I really appreciate that. And with the new blood in the orchestra, I believe Hopper, you will be the great and the first viola in the future. So now we will start off with a mysterious and exciting Dance of Gypsy by Camille Saint-Saëns. Please enjoy. Thank you.
very much. Our next piece is going to be introduced by Isabel.
Hello everyone, my name is Isabel. I'm a senior. This next piece was composed by Doug Ladd, who you might know as Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. And we will be playing his Symphony in F, with a lot of letters after it, because he wrote a lot of this. If I'm not mistaken, this piece was written by a young teenage Mozart. And as a vibrant piece, he had so much fun rehearsing it during the day. Whether it be as a welcome break or fun intermission to all the work. So I hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
You sounded really good today.
Great.
Yeah. Can you give the students another round of applause?
Rehearsed 2 days leading up to a concert, and so everyone had the music prepared ahead of time. And so when I walked into orchestra a couple weeks later, I was completely surprised to see this sitting on the stand. And I asked Mr. Bradley, are we really playing this? And so over the next couple of months, we learned this piece, and it's been really great to play with this orchestra and have played different parts that I never played before. And so I hope you enjoy it as much as I enjoy.
Thank you. My students have worked so hard. Your children have worked so hard. Yes. All right. I will start preaching, but I'm going to wait. Okay. So next, Mingyu is going to introduce this amazing piece.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Mingyu Zhou, and I'm a senior at Fern Central. So this next piece we're going to play is called Juhatai, which is translated into English called Chrysanthemum Terrace. And the composer and singer of this song is Jay Cho. And people of my generation grew up listening to him. And to me, he's a really a legend. And in my opinion, he's the first musician who beautifully combined pop music and ancient Chinese lyrics and chords together. And at the beginning of this semester, I suggested this song to Mr. Bradley. And he creates this amazing version of the song for our orchestra. And I cannot appreciate that more. And this is a really beautiful piece, and I got really emotional every time I play it. So please enjoy.
Before we play this, I just want, there's like a dramatic progression in this piece. This is one of the cool things about being at our school, is that the music can be tailored for certain kinds of experiences. So what you'll notice is that once the orchestra sets the stage, what I was imagining was the young Mingyu, like being about 12. And so the piano part fits that age. And then as we get going, she gets older and older, to finally, at the end, she's like who she is today. So that's the idea. Now, you may not get it, but it's there. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
sang, their mom was saying, one more orchestra concert. And I was like, yeah, that's right, one more. And the value of that ritual of having that once again every year is so special for me as a teacher. Not only do I get to linger on the emotional intensity of what it means to grow up, because that's really crucial, to never get a lead touch. Like, it's such a magical, spiritual experience. Now, you're watching your child grow up, but so are your teachers. And I think that what's so beautiful for me is the pain of that experience every year. Saying goodbye to so many wonderful people every year. I'm being honest with you, because I feel that you need honesty if you have a senior. There's something so remarkable about being able to have a relationship that goes throughout the years, and then to finally wish our students good luck with their fortunes and their futures. It's such a remarkable thing. The reason I'm saying that is because I'd like our seniors on stage to stand so that you all can applaud them. Okay. But you are listening to the time period that you live in. And he came up with this great idea, which is he wrote little segments of the piece. And there, that's the score. So if you are able to read music,
you went to French Central, you should be able to.
You should be able to follow the score. Because if we played the whole thing, it would last like 45 minutes. And the jazz band wants to play. So we're not gonna do that. But we're gonna cut it short. But I think it's long enough for you to get a sense of just how revolutionary this piece is. The first thing that I want you to notice is that there is no beat. In our country, there's always one, one. But he took that concept and he said, what if you had your own one, and you had your one, because that's the way the world is. Everybody has their own one, and that's what's so beautiful about it. So how this works is we each play this with our own tempo, our own one, and we don't play it together. None of this stuff should happen together. It should be a swirl of sounds. That's the goal. Now, it'll start with C's repeating. So Charlie, can you play those C's? Can you go a little slower? Okay, so these C's are gonna be going through the whole piece as a reference point for you. And we'll be playing this, and after it's over with, after your mind has been blown, you can thank us for this experience. You didn't even need to take any drugs. I'm sure that's what it took for him to write this piece. So enjoy this, and thank you so much for being such a great audience tonight.
Thank you. That's such a beautiful song. And
I think several years ago, we learned how to play it. There was this guy named Robbie Wimble who graduated, and this is one of the pieces that he wanted to do. So I'm going to turn this mic over to Camilla. She's going to introduce our first piece.
Hi everyone, I'm Camilla. I'm a senior. So Scrapple from Apple is a bebop composition written by Charlie Parker in 1947. And Charlie Parker was a master jazz composer and saxophonist. And bebop was a form of jazz characterized by fast tempos and advanced harmonies. And so this piece based on the chords of Honeysuckle Rose and I Got Rhythm. These were both songs that Parker played as a teenager. So this song must mean a lot for him. And it sounds really catchy and melodic, and it stays around my mind like after the practice. So I hope you enjoy it. We'll be right back.
So our next piece is going to be introduced by Gab. Hi everybody, I'm Gavin, I'm a senior here. Next piece is called The Selma March, and it's written by one of my favorite jazz guitarists, Grant Green. It was written in 1965, right after the Voting Rights Act was signed, and the melody of the song is just like the nastiest, most funky thing that you could ever hear. And ever since I've heard it, I can never stop singing the melody, and I wrote it in last year, and unfortunately we weren't able to play it. So I knew that that was going to be one of the pieces that I was going to choose. Yeah, so here it goes. Hope you like it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi again. So this next piece is by one of my favorite artists, D'Angelo. And he was like one of the, in the 90s, he was like, he had an album called Brown Sugar, and it was one of the top R&B albums, and he was just incredible jazz pianist, R&B vocalist, and he stopped making music for a while, and he actually took up guitar. And in 2007, he wrote this song called Really Love. And that was when he originally wrote it, and he didn't end up releasing it until 2014. It was the single off of his album, Black Messiah, which was his first album since, I think, the late 90s. And just, the song just has the most beautiful melody. There's no other way to put it. It's about love, and it just captures just the purity and the essence of it. And yeah, so we're gonna try to play. Thank you.
that might take a second, so I'm just going to talk for longer. But that's okay, because I have a lot to say about this piece. So, this piece is by a kind of like niche, not well-known musician, but like, just in case, has anybody heard of a guy named Jimi Hendrix?
Oh yeah!
Oh yeah! We're about to play a Jimi Hendrix piece. It's called Bold as Love. It's my favorite song of all time. Thank you. It's from a collection of three masterpieces that he has called Axis. And a few things you should know about this piece. One, it's one of the hardest guitar pieces ever written. Two, it's a hard rock piece. And we're a jazz band. So we have a group full of high schoolers playing one of the most like difficult music pieces ever written. And then we also have a jazz band playing a rock piece. So nothing about this should go right. Nothing. And it won't, if you're worried. That's the next thing I want to say about this piece, is that it's really experimental and it's really hard. And because it's so hard, we've learned a lot through the process of playing. So I want to tell just a quick story about a learning experience that the band had. And I want you to think of these lessons while we're playing the piece and soak them in, because I think like that'll inform the way you hear the piece, so you can know what's behind it. So I'm just gonna tell a quick story. Like I said, this is my favorite song ever. I've been dreaming of playing it with Mr. Bradley for all of high school. When we started working on it, it was like a dream come true. And sometimes I would just cry in practice because I was so happy that we were playing this. And it was so amazing, and he's so amazing, I just cried. Like, you ever just look at him and want to cry? But then we kept playing the piece, and we discovered how hard it was. It's so hard. And I started to get really sad because I couldn't play it. And none of us could really play it because it's a ludicrous thing to do. So I started like crying the other emotion in practice because I was so sad. And it was like my dream was being crushed. And there was this one day I came in and I played it and I thought I did really bad. And I walked out really upset. And then this guy stopped me and he was like, "Hey, that was really beautiful. Your hard work paid off." And I looked at him and all I could think was, is he drunk? Like, what? But then after some reflection, I realized that here is where the lesson is. He didn't care how precisely we played the really hard piece, but I think he knew that it was my favorite song of all time and that we were on this crazy adventure together. So there was something really magical about it, even if we weren't playing it like Jimi Hendrix played it. And what I learned from that is like, it just, nothing matters. Like, if I'm gonna get up there and I'm gonna mess up the whole time, and I'm gonna fumble through it and you're all gonna see it, and it doesn't matter at all. Because this is this band's last time ever playing together. It's my last time playing with like this amazing conductor, and that's all that matters. Who cares if I mess up? I'm gonna, we're all gonna. And we're all, you're all.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm on. This piece we're about to play is by a modern jazz band called Snarky Puppy. It's called Taroba. It's kind of just a jam song, and it's our last piece of the night. You're gonna watch all of us jam and have fun, and that means you're gonna have fun. Right?
Yeah!
Let us just take a moment before we play this, just acknowledge our seniors. First there's Camilla, who started last year with us and brought up her elegance and piano playing. I thought she did a wonderful, wonderful job. And we want to thank her for being a part of our beautiful band. You heard Nina talk, and it's hard to put into words the poetry that she brings to our verses. I think that the musical chemistry of our group has a great deal to do with the way people communicate with each other. And what I've always loved about Nina is that, and I told her this the other day, I always feel like Nina is always herself. Ever since I met her in middle school, this sense of ethical purpose. It's really hard to situate yourself in that arena, but because of this, the brutal honesty that she has about the process of making music is just so wonderful to be around. So she was talking about an experience that she had, but what I was remembering was feeling so emotionally giddy that she had accomplished this. And what I love so much about having time with her is the spiritual connection she has with music, which I'm sure she will continue throughout her life. I just want to thank Nina. There's one more senior to thank, and I met Gavin when he was, I think, in the fifth grade, and I remember at the time we were in my room. And one of the seniors who was graduating that year, her name was Paula Burkhart. And she wrote me a note after this day. And she said she was worried when she graduated, where is Mr. Bradley going to find people who love music the way we do, the seniors after graduating? And then she was in this room with this young Gavin Sultan. And she said she saw the future there. And it was just so reassuring. And I was thinking how that lineage of loving music and being a part of music is so important to us. Gavin's changed a lot of things at the school. We have a recording studio downstairs because of him. Not me, because of him. I think that deserves it. The most sparkling thing about Gavin, and there's so many things, is his tremendous ability to dive in to the honest part of the piece and to feel and acknowledge the greatness of music. And that has come through our rehearsals, that has come again and again through our wonderful conversations that we've had over the years. And I continue to feel very blessed that I'm here on this planet and that I get a chance to be around such an extraordinary young man. And I can't wait to see what he does with his musical gift that is really precious. Thank you so much, Gavin. That's what my mom used to say. She didn't sound like it. So, thank you so much for being here tonight.
And it just changed the way that I look at music and hear it, and it also allowed me to
explore so many different kinds of music I've never heard before. And after that class, I went on Spotify and listened to like a million different new artists: Helen Wolf, Mari, Bessie Smith. I'm like, okay, I'll wrap it up. And then in my junior year, I had an English assignment where I had to do, I had to interview 3 people about the American dream and what they thought the American dream meant to them and how they defined success. And so I went to Mr. Bradley and we had a 20-minute conversation about what success is and what the American dream is all about. And all the people that he mentioned that embodied the dream to him and success to him were all people, not necessarily who were the most wealthy or the people who were the most famous, but just everyday people who were passionate about what they do. And at the end of my high school experience, looking back, Mr. Ravi is the perfect person who embodies all of that. He just comes to school every single day and he loves what he does, he truly does. He would do anything for the music, he would do anything for the students, the seniors, and there's no way, we can't thank you enough. I mean, you just meant so much to me and everyone else, and I don't think you know the impact you've had. And just like a word of advice to like the underclassmen is just like, I know sometimes it can be really intimidating, like putting yourself out there and playing music in front of such a big group, especially when you're younger. But if you ever have a problem in jazz band, just talk to Mr. Bradley. That like was the most liberating thing, I think. And I didn't realize that until like sophomore year. And yeah, but you can't thank him enough.
Website online, and because I went on the website in December, so I saw this picture of orchestra going to Liberty Place, and it's on the website, and I thought, wow, that school hall is huge, and that's why I applied and ended up being here, and because I was thinking, oh, I can play in the orchestra and being that beautiful school hall. But anyways, that didn't end up being our school hall, but I did end up being the orchestra. And it was truly it's just amazing to, because I used to play piano solo for a long time, and being a pianist in the orchestra does change a lot of the ways I think about music, think about playing music with other people. And so I ended up being the pianist and part-time percussionist and part-time page trainer for 3 years. And I think because being an international student here really means a lot to me, and it definitely brought a lot of different experience for me. And every time when I think about Chopin, which is the showpiece we played, I was thinking about how beautiful it is, and I think I was thinking about like the last time I played it, I will reconcile with all my memories here as an international student, good or bad, with my friends or with my teachers, and I think that's what I did tonight. And I really want to thank Mr. Bradley for bringing all these amazing experiences in my life. When I was playing piano at 12, I didn't think there would be this moment. So yeah, thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay. Okay, I'll try and keep it really, really brief. Oh. Yeah, okay. We'll just, each the rest of us will just share a few sentences of thank yous. Basically, Mr. Bradley didn't just make me a better musician, but he made me a better person. And that's the kind of power that he has. Just working with him makes him a better person. And we're all so incredibly lucky to have that.
Like I said earlier, I didn't know how to play. I came here only to play a half year for viola. And it's, the interesting about the orchestra is that it gives you a place to sit in, but you actually have to work hard to actually fit in. But once you sync in with the whole group, I feel really wonderful. Thank you, Ms. Riley. Although that might be the last time I'm playing a viola. thank you for the ride. It's really yours. Thanks.
So there are too many memories of my experiences with Mr. Bradley and Jazz Band. So the one thing that I want to share is Mr. Bradley always talks to me and also other students like a family member. Like he makes me feel I can talk about everything with him. And music and something that not having happened in life that I can talk to him and find a place to rest. And I joined jazz band last year in my junior year. It was hard, but like jazz band practice time is a really important, really like relaxed time for me. And also I joined History of African Music class with Mr. Bradley this year, and I like have a deeper understanding of American history through learning the music. And I think like jazz is a kind of freedom, like means freedom, because you could just play anything based on that chords or melody, and it's really exciting. And thank you so much, Mr. Bradley, to let me join jazz band and let me join your class.
Hey, the very, very last thing I promise to do it really quick is our gift for him. He's been kind of sick this semester, so we wanted to get him something healing. So we got him a tea set for his room.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you.